Hello, future architects. My name is Architect Argel V. Calanday, and today we're going to discuss climate and environment for our Unit 120. But before we proceed with our discussion, let me give you a motivation to start your this discussion right. So, meron isang lalaki na bago pumanaw daw yung tatay niya, kinausap siya. Tapos may binigay sa kanya yung tatay niya na maliit na bato. Small lang. So sabi ng tatay niya, anak, ito lang kaya kong maipamana sa'yo. Ngayon, itong lalaki, nagtataka siya. Aanhin ko tong bato na to. Kahit saan, pwede ako makapulot nito eh, sabi niya. So sabi ng tatay niya, humanap ka ng lugar kung saan mo pwede yan maibenta. Tapos, after that, pumanaw na yung tatay niya. Ngayon, etong lalaki na paisip siya. Sinong bibili ng batong ito? Pero, sinabi sa kanya ng tatay niya, huling habilin sa kanya ng tatay niya, na humanap siya kung saan niya pwedeng maibenta yung batong yun. So, pumunta siya ng palengke. Pagpunta niya sa palengke, pinagtanong-tanong niya, magkano niya po bibili nitong bato na to? Sabi ng mga tindera at tindero doon, bakit ko bibili niyang bato na yan? Wala naman niyang kwenta. Ngayon, umalis siya dun sa palengke. Naisip niya siguro sa museum or sa antique. Baka sa antique shop, bilin yun. So ngayon, pumunta siya sa antique shop. Pinakita niya dun sa nagbabantay. Magkano niyo po bibili nito? Sabi ng antique shop owner, sige, bilin ko sa iyo ng 500 pesos. Ngayon, napaisip yung lalaki, 500 pesos? Ito na ba yung pamana sa akin ng tatay ko? So sabi niya doon sa antique owner, sige, babalikan ko po kayo. Ngayon, habang naglalakad-lakad siya, meron siyang nakitang isang store na ang nakalagay precious stone. So medyo na-curious siya. Precious stone? So pinuntahan niya, pinasok niya, tapos tinanong niya yung nagbabantay. Sir, magkano niyo po bibili nitong bato na to? Sabi nung nagbabantay, sige, patingin muna. So, tinignan nung nagbabantay. Tinitingnan nung nagbabantay, tapos biglang sumigaw yung nagbabantay. Nako, sir! Saan niyo po ito nakuha? Napaka mamahaling bato po nito. Pwede ko pong mabili sa inyo for 10 million pesos. Ang tawag po sa bato na ito ay serendipite. Mukha lang talaga siyang bato, pero napakamamahalin po nito. So nagulat yung lalaki. Ano yung moral of the story? So kung ikaw, pakiramdam mo ay parang wala kang kwenta, ibig sabihin nasa maling lugar ka. Maling tao yung mga kasama mo, maling tao yung mga kaibigan mo. So ang kailangan mong gawin ay humanap ka ng mga tamang tao na makikita ang tunay mong halaga. So madalas itong mga tao na ito, kapag alam nila ang tunay mong halaga, hihilain ka nila pataas. So yung mga topics na i-cover natin today is list down on this down. So hindi ko ma-edit yung aking katawan dito, but these are the topics that we are gonna discuss for today. The dilemma, no? Bakit kailangan nating mag-design considering yung climate and environment, no? Bakit yun important? So subsequently, kinote siya ni Vitruvius, a Roman author, civil and military engineer, during that first century that yung mga buildings daw kailangan in harmony with climate. So kapag nagde-design tayo ng mga building, yung designer, kailangan aware siya sa microclimate at sa epekto nun sa tao. And the building itself. So as we all know from the definition ng microclimate, is it is different at the times from the more significant climate. So it's very severe na dapat i-consider natin yung climate change crisis na nangyayari ngayong era natin. So yung burning o yung pagsunog ng mga fossil fuels is yung critical na contributor ng phenomenon na yun. So dahil doon, nagkakaroon ng increase sa carbon dioxide production sa hangin. na nakakaapekto sa Earth's surface. And because of that, yung Earth's surface nag-i-emit siya ng long wave radiation. Yung long wave radiation na yun ay nagko-cause ng heating on the ground and the atmosphere level. So yung phenomenon na yun tinatawag natin greenhouse effect. So because of that, nagkakaroon ng pagbabago sa klima sa iba't ibang parts ng mundo. It is too late now to stop the climate change. But we can somehow limit o limitahan yung epekto na to bilang tayo as future architects. And sa mga panibagong pagsusuri ngayon sa ating sa science and technology, we can cause to create natural healing of our earth by using ancient techniques that our ancestors did in their methods of construction. So, kailangan nating magbalik-tanaw. Ano ba yung mga methods of construction na ginagawa ng mga ninuno natin doon, dati, before technology arises? So, kung iisipin natin nung nakaraan, di ba? As we go back to our past styles of method of construction, talagang ang makikita natin yung environment and climate nun, wala pang masyadong effect. Wala pang climate change nun. Everything is normal, no? Kaya yung methods of construction nun, parang nagkokos siya na hindi siya ganoon kasama yung epekto niya sa ating environment. So, with recent studies, it was promoted na we have to adapt to the old ways of methods of construction to somehow create yung natural na pag-heal ng Earth, no? By limiting the effect of carbon footprint na napoproduce sa pagkoconstruct natin ng mga buildings. So, we should be more on climate responsive facilities that are gentle in our environment na less yung energy during and after the construction. However, para ma-design natin siya, kailangan alamin muna natin what climate is. So, climate is from the Greek word klima, which means the slope of the earth and the sun. So, sa dati, nung history natin, ano, kung natatandaan nyo yung Greek architecture, yung Greeks, dinivide nila yung mundo. Imagine, dinivide nila yung mundo based sa climate. Kaya nagkaroon tayo ng tropic, temperate, and arctic regions. So, yung climate noon binase ng mga ancient Greeks dahil sa pag-function ng araw through the solar angles or latitude. Okay? So, yung atmosphere daw, it is an essential, plays an essential role in the temperature that the sun emits. So, yung atmosphere daw is a heat machine. It is a heat machine that is fueled by the sun. So yun yung nagiging parang nagja-generate ng heat coming from the sun. So sinasalo lahat ni atmosphere yung lahat ng solar energy coming from our sun. So yung central heating occurs on the Earth's surface since the energy is transparent to solar power. So, central heating of air. So, yung atmosphere bilang heat machine na napu-fuel ng sun, so siya yung nagko-cause para yung land mass or yung energy ma-transfer from our land mass back to the atmosphere. So, heated air arises. Ayun. So, once na-transfer na ni atmosphere yung heat from the ground level, heat air arises. And it creates low pressure area. Kapag tumaas yung heat, it will generate low pressure area sa ground level. So, since the earth is not heated equally, because it causes low and high pressure regions because of the wind. So, ang equator lang yung center of the sun's radiation, right? Yung north and south, hindi sila masyadong tinatamaan. So, yun ang ibig sabihin na it is not heated equally. So, because of that, nagkakaroon ng low and high pressure regions because of the wind. The primary source of heat in the atmosphere is interaction with the solar to heated ground. So, solar heated ground. When we say solar heated ground, ito yung pag-conduct ng heat coming from the atmosphere through our landmass. So, kapag ka na-collecta na ng mass, mag-e-emit siya back into the space. So, yun yung sinasabi ko kanina, when the energy is transferred from the atmosphere to the landmass, it will generate heat because of the convection na nangyayari sa lupa natin. So, because of that, in the summer, there is a gain and a loss in the winter. So, winter, wala tayo, only rainy seasons. So, this was actually roughly a century ago when artificial global warming began. So, dati ito, nung wala pang global warming, ganito yung scenario ng solar to heated ground. But now, meron na tayong climate change. And so, because of that, the north to south airflow is generated to the equator. Nagkakaroon tayo ng global flow changes in the season and rotation of the earth. So, yung north and south flow is generated because of the heat coming from the equator, because nagpo-produce siya ng low pressure area, yung north and south, nagpo-produce naman siya ng high pressure area, and then because of that, nagkakaroon ng global flow changes in the season because it really depends on the rotation of the earth, kung saan siya nakatutok na part. So our earth rotates as it orbits around the sun. So because of that, nagkakaroon ng global flow changes. So yung variety ng land masses nakakaapekto din ano. So hindi lang naman flat yung earth surface natin. There are mountainous regions, there are sea, there are flatlands, etc. So because of also that, it is one of the factor na nagke-create ng distribution ng winds. So it is really a significant factor. So continents with high heating capacity and conductivity, or the ability to transfer heat from one surface to another, make the water surface inevitable to heat or cooling as fast as land. So ibig sabihin lang, yung continents na may mas malawak na land masses, because land is much more easily transfer heat. Diba sa science natin, diba? Nung high school pa lang tayo na pag-aralan na natin, na yung land masses is much more prone to mas mataas yung conductivity ng heat level niya versus the water. So in conclusion, yung change in temperature in the water is more moderated, no, than in land, which means bodies of water gain temperature slowly comparing to land. The farther the ground surface from any bodies of water, of course, the higher the temperature. So kung gaano yung kalayo yung, let's say for example, yung site natin sa bodies of water, of course, mas mataas yung heat level na doon. So kung mas malapit siya sa water surface, of course, mas malamig yung magiging temperature doon, because of the variation of the conduction of heat. So this north to south flow is called Coriolis force. So It is caused by the Earth's rotation deflecting the north-south air currents. So, yun yung tawag sa north to south. Other term for the north to south airflow generated because of the equator. So, as we all know, di ba sinabi natin, nagkakaroon ng distribution of winds because of the variety of land masses. So, mountain ranges play a significant role in the moisture content of the air. Why? Because they block and help divert the winds. That's the simple concept behind that. So, humidity sa mga mountainous region, alam natin na mataas. So, because of that, humidity in most mountainous regions is high because of the evaporation that takes place due to solar radiation. So, because of that, it will lead to forming of clouds, rain, or snow because of the condensation that will take place in this mountainous region. So, ibig sabihin lang, mataas yung humidity level sa mga mountainous regions because of its height. So, mas malapit yung distance from the sun. So, because of that, mas madaling mag-evaporate yung mga moisture content natin. Thus, it will lead to forming of clouds, rain or snow, and then condensation that will take place on this mountainous region. So, on the other side of the mountain, as you can see from the picture, drier air falls because of the airflow directed downward. So the higher our moisture content elevates from a much higher place, the cooler it will be during the day. So the higher yung moisture content natin sa specific place, of course, it is directly proportional to how much our temperature will be much cooler in that day. So, on the other side of the mountain range, it will provide a much drier air from the mountain range because of what we call rain shadow. So, yung rain shadow daw, it is the shadow that is cast on the other side that marks the decrease in temperature. So, okay. So, rain shadows, as noticed, cause scattered rainfall. So, yung rain shadow daw is yung na-form na moisture content, evaporation, condensation, and then it will be formed into rain. So, yung shadow na na-form from the clouds coming from the mountainous regions, yun yung nagsisilbing moisture block cast on the other side. So, it decreases the temperature because of this, of the clouds blocking the solar radiation coming from the sun. So, at night, mountains create local winds. So, local winds, the air next to the mountain surface during the day heats up, and the nearby place around the mountain is prone to heating because of the free altitude of the same height. So, yung diverted winds na coming from the mountain, it caused to create the local winds. So, yung local winds, kung malapit siya sa ating mountain surface during the day, it is heated up. So, mas mainit yung mga breeze na na-experience natin near the mountain surface. And, of course, there is a temperature variation. The more your structure is located at a higher place, the cooler your atmosphere will be. So, yun yung sinasabi ko kanina, that if your site is in a much more elevated plane, it is the cooler or mas malamig yung temperature na may experience nyo during that day. So, warm air moves up the slope during the day and the process is reversed at night. So, warm air moves up during the slope of the day. So, warm air moves up. So, because of yung during daytime, yung lahat ng moisture content natin nasa taas, ano? Hindi, wala siya sa ground level. So yung tendency, yung air next to the mountain surface is much more yung warm air, tumataas siya during the day. And of course, kapag ka na-reverse na yung temperature natin, of course, when the sun is setting, yun, nagsaset yung sun, of course, yung temperature level natin during the day decreases. So, nagkakaroon ng reversion. So, hindi na yung mga, yung cold air yung nasa taas, yung cold air na yung nasa ground level. And then, our hot air is in the atmosphere. So, yun ang, yung phenomenon na yun nagka-cause ng create strong winds in the narrow valley up along the valley floor during that day and down the valley at night. At the center of the mountain, of course, yung diverted wind is coming downwards. So, magsasalubong yun, may tendency yung free air natin papunta sa taas. So, of course, yung diverted winds na yun naman, ang tinatawag nating warm air, it goes up during the day. And of course, kapag bumababa ang temperature natin, nagkakaroon ng reversal sa atmosphere. Yung heat temperature natin from the above goes down in a much more cooler state because of the temperature, temperature decrease. So yung cold air is coming down when the sun sets also. So, yun lang yung gawin yung basehan, guys. As the sun sets, also, yung temperature comes down. So, when our site is near large bodies of water, a similar day-to-night reversal of wind occurs. So, same lang. Same lang sa mountainous regions. Kung malapit naman siya sa large bodies of water, may tendency na yung warm air is going upwards and the cool air goes down during the night. So, properties of water due to its large heat capacity and conductivity prevents it from heating or cooling as fast as the land. So, mas mabagal siyang lumamig, mas mabagal din siyang uminit. So, bodies of water compared from the ground are much more extensively tolerant in heat. So the conductivity of level of land versus water is higher. So air flows in temperature are reversed during the night. So of course, kung ang airflow natin during the day is papunta sa land, at night reverse na yung process, yung land breeze natin papunta na sa sea. Okay? So air flows in temperature is reversed during the night. There is no breeze in the late afternoon to the early morning because of the temperature difference. It creates current and pressure. So yung temperature difference na to, mapapansin natin because yung conductivity level natin ng land is mas madaling mag-store ng heat yung landmass. Of course, yung landmass natin mas mainit. And of course, yung sea breeze, yung sea bodies of water natin is matagal siyang uminit. So of course, medyo malamig pa yung atmosphere dito. So yung pag nagsalubong yung dalawa na yun, it creates a pressure. Yung current and pressure na yun, it creates that breeze. Yung temperature difference between those two. Sea breezes are generated because of that resultant pressure differences between our land and sea. Airflow is reversed during the night, as you've seen on this picture, and there are no breezes in the late afternoon and the early morning when the land and sea are at the same temperature. So pag na-experience natin na wala talagang hangin near the bodies of water or the sea, ang tendency nun is magka-sing init at sing lamig lang, or mag-same lang yung temperature between the land versus the sea. So, walang pressure na nag-generate si land and sea. And then, it will result to no pressure. Pagka walang pressure, wala ding sea breezes. So, suppose there is no temperature variation between the land and sea. In that case, there will be no generating of pressure to create that sea breeze. So the variation in temperature between the land and sea is minor since night breezes are weaker during the day. So there are few temperature differences between land and sea in the evenings. So yung breezes daw natin is much more weaker during the day. And there are a few temperature differences between land and sea in the morning. So mapapansin nyo, yung at night, yung sea breezes natin are much more softer. And at the day, mas malakas yung sea breezes natin. So meaning yung temperature difference ng land and sea are maliit lang yung pagkakaiba during the night. So kapag mababa yung pressure na ma-generate nun, mas mahina yung draft or yung breeze na mapaproduce ng temperature difference. So kapag ka naman mataas yung difference ng temperature between the land and sea, it will cause to create a stronger current of drafts. So yun ang nagdidikta kung gaano kalakas yung breeze natin. So the ambient temperature is affected by the amount of moisture in the air. So because of the generated temperature, the land is much more colder compared to the sea. So it conducts heat and cools down much quicker because of its properties. So because yung moisture in the air na napoproduce ng draft, naapektuhan yung ambient temperature. So of course, kung malakas yung breeze, of course, the ambient temperature is much more cooler. Okay? So because of the generated temperature, mas madaling lumamig yung land. Okay? Keep it in mind. And then kapag mas madaling lumamig yung land, of course, yung surrounding surfaces, because yung conductivity level ng land is much more higher, mabilis siyang uminit, mabilis din siyang lumamig, mabilis niyang nai-distribute yung temperature na nararanasan niya in those situations. So because of that, nagkakaroon ng much more ambient temperature. So it easily conducts heat and cold because sa kanyang property. In conclusion, dry climates have little moisture to block radiation and low humidity levels. So the high humidity level and moisture content of the place result in the production of clouds. So of course, sa dry climates, mapapansin nyo kapag ka nasa disyerto ka, kumwari, di ba? Nakikita mo, wala talagang clouds. Talagang tutok yung araw sa'yo because of low moisture content now. So kapag ka mataas yung moisture content ng isang lugar, it will cause to produce clouds. So yung clouds na yun, ang tendency niya is to block the long wave radiation coming from the sun. So hindi lang trees or puno yung nakakapag-block ng radiation, of course, also the clouds because it stores the moisture content on that specific area. So of course, for example natin is Baguio, no? In that morning of December, imagine you are in Baguio. You will see many fog patches due to high moisture content in that specific place. Yung fog na yon, nag-help siya para i-block yung long wave radiation na nanggagaling sa araw. And because of that, mas bumababa yung temperature natin. Because naman na maliit or little moisture sa mga dry areas, to hinder radiation, daytime temperatures are high, of course. So dry areas. Mataas ang temperature and yung nocturnal temperatures are very low. So sa umaga, sobrang init sa dry climates. But kapag ka sumapit ang gabi, because the land have higher conductivity rates, pagka pag-set na ng araw, mas mabilis maglumamig yung place. So kapag gabi, mababa yung temperature sa dry climates. So because of that, yung diurnal temperature variation natin is malaki. Water, in the form of humidity and particularly clouds, blocks both solar and long wave radiation. As a result, daytime temperature are lower in damp or cloudy regions. So mas mababa ang temperature sa mga cloudy or damp regions, and nighttime temperatures are higher than in hot and dry climates. So as a result, the daily range of temperature is very wide. no, mas mataas yung wide ng pagkakaiba-iba ng temperature natin because of the different climates that we are experiencing in different regions of our world. So let's head on to our next subtopic, which is the microclimate. So the atmospheric interactions of various purposes forms diverse sets of climates. So thus, there are different climatic regions in multiple places of our countries. So hindi lang tayo dapat mag-focus sa regional aspects of climate because of the climate change. Marami pa rin, diverse pa din yung nararanasan nating climate in each particular place, sub place na meron tayo or location na nandoon tayo. So because of the atmospheric interaction differs because of the other surfaces like land surfaces, topography, mountain ranges, and many factors, nagkakaroon ng diverse climate. And if it is near the sea, the temperature will also be different. So because of that, the climate differs in many parts of our country. So microclimate is a local climate that can be different in the climate region in which it is found. So halimbawa sa Luzon, mostly are sa Philippines, no, summer. Pero dito sa specific place na to umuulan. So yun yung is example ng microclimate. So it varies in the major varies in the major climate that we're experiencing as a region or as a country. So microclimate, from the word itself, micro, so sa smaller parts of the country, we experience different set of climate or temperature changes. So there are different factors, no, affecting the microclimate, deviating from the microclimate. So these are in this list down below. So first thing we're gonna focus is the elevation above sea level. So of course, always bear in mind with the increase in height, the temperature will drop faster. An example is Baguio. So an increase in elevation level, the faster the rate of lowering the temperature. The next is the form of land. Slopes facing the south are much more warmer than the north because they receive more solar radiation. So any orientation from north to south is excellent for light and heat coming from the sun. South-facing slopes can receive up to 100 times more solar radiation than the north-facing slopes. So when we are orienting buildings, mas mataas yung solar radiation ng south orientation versus the north. Pero iba pa rin yung magiging temperature difference niya kapag sinama na natin si east and west. So that's another story. Because cold air is heavier than warm air, it drains into low-lying places, generating cold air pools, as you can see from the picture. So it really depends, no? Yung climate na or yung climate na na-experience natin sa form of land na meron dun sa paligid ng site natin. So of course, kapag ka nandoon tayo sa valley, of course, yung tendency, yung cold air is always dragged down, ano? Mas mabigat yung cold air versus the heavier air. Ang tendency kapag ka sumalpok siya doon sa form of land na mas mataas, sa structure mo, ang tendency is magkakaroon ng pool of air, cold air, doon sa mismong site mo. So if you imagine, ano, halimbawa, nandito, si structure mo sa may mismong mountain region na yun, sa gilid. So of course, yung pool of air ma-receive fully ng structure mo. So it depends on the form of land that is affecting the microclimate that we experience. And then the soil types. So different soil types conducts heat levels higher compared to the others. So, may iba-ibang type of soil na nagko-conduct ng heat level versus the others. So, iba-iba pa din. So, of course, kapag ka mas mataas yung conductivity level ng isang soil type to the others, to the other, mas mabilis uminit doon sa place na yun. So, during the day, ganito yung process, yung soils or rocks collect heat. So, imagine that the rocks and soils are collecting heat during the day. And then, pagkatapos nila makontain yung heat na yun, it will then be released at night. So, that's why yung temperature range natin is much more colder in the night time. Because yung na-store na heat during the day, it will dissipate, no? Upwards, no? Pataas lahat ng heat level, and then of course that will cause to a much more lower temperature after the heat level is then released. So in dry climates, people tend to use underground structures as a residence because the high mass of heat does not directly affect their space. So imagine, no? Kung gaano kalamig yung structure, yung hinihiga nila kapag gabi, kapag underground. So after all, it is absorbed and then release the heat slowly until the sun sets. And then a much more comfortable temperature at night will be experienced. Vegetations, the more greenery around the site is the significant the reduction of the air or ground temperature by means of shading. So clouds can block heat, of course, because of the moisture content na meron yung clouds. But even also the foliage or plants are said to increase the humidity of a place. So yung humidity or yung increase ng humidity level ng isang place by using the vegetation, ang tawag natin doon is evapotranspiration. Yung evapotranspiration is a term that refers to a process that combines yung soil evaporation and plant evaporation. So yung soil nag-evaporate because of conductivity level, so do the plant then because they are producing oxygen. So combine those two and it creates humidity level. Okay? So in hot spots, the breezes, it is ideal to have a dense canopy of trees to provide shade. But no low growing plants because yung cold air natin, which is heavier than the hot air, may tendency siya na mas mababa yung pag-flow niya through our buildings. And that's why yung place na yon or yung hindi recommended yung paggamit ng low-growing plants because it will just increase the humidity level in that place and not obstruct na. Now, and then at the same time, na obstruct niya yung breeze. So low growing plants must be particularly spaced because it may lead also, gaya ng sinasabi ko, to an undesirable humidity level because yung stagnant air na nakakreate ng trees and the shrubs. So vegetation or the foliage can also help to divert the winds. Plus, plants can reduce their cooling effects in cold climates, reducing the noise and cleaning dust and other pollutants. So, alam naman natin from our elementary and high school days that the plants are very useful when it comes to cleaning the dust particles and producing oxygen for us. And also, sa architecture, ngayon nyo lang nalaman na it can also reduce the noise coming from the street. Artificial structures. So because of the abundance of the buildings, roadways, and parkings, lots have many effects on microclimate. So tall buildings nakakapag-create na ng shade, just like trees, from the summer sun, and also can block the wind. So asphalts and pavements are said to generate heat as high as 140 degrees. That's why nililimit na lang natin yung paggamit ng paved surfaces versus the unpaved surfaces. So because nakakapag-generate nga siya ng as high as 140 degrees. So as you have seen from the graphs behind me, so, yung comparison from the dense forest to the urban city, yung temperature niya is much higher from the graph. As you can see, mas tumaas siya, no? Then, mas mababa na sa mga dense or sa mga mas mapupunong lugar. So, so be careful on constructing high pavement areas because it will just generate heat afterward. So, developing a large building to the south can transform a gloriously sunny and wind-protected southern exposure into a frigid, windy microclimate, an illustration of a typical urban heat island profile. So, urban heat island, yung na-experience natin, the increase in temperature in the city. So because yun nga, nagkalat yung pavements dyan, yung concretes dyan, it's a concrete jungle. So the higher our paved surfaces are, maraming nagko-conduct ng heat. And imagine that 140 degrees, di ba? Napaka-init nun, guys. So be careful and be considerate when using your proportions on the site, your paved to unpaved surfaces. So, yung graph na nasa likod ko is an example of a profile hypothetical metropolitan of a hypothetical metropolitan area that are connected with the density of development and trees. So, more on microclimate. In this part, I want to present scenarios that entail how we can quickly analyze climate and how it will affect our building or structure. So as we all know, microclimate entails to the difference of climate depending on the geographical location of our structures. These geographical conditions varies the microclimate condition on the following factors. So number one is the temperature difference. So each area, depending on the amount of humidity level in that specific place, will dictate how much cooler or hotter that place will be. The second is the site location. So imagine your structure na located sa mountainous regions like Baguio City. So of course, yung structure natin will now then adapt to the existing climate conditions, no? So some of the houses in Baguio City tend to use much smaller windows because, for example, we want it to have little windows to retain the heat coming from the sun. So as much as possible, kailangan ma-retain yung heat coming from the sun. So that's why yung primary purpose natin, why we consider climate as a design consideration, is a huge plus when you initial or when you're just starting your initial design phase. So, all in all, climate differs in geographical conditions. And because of that, again, you have to consider the materials that you will be using in your structure. So, if it is in the mountainous region, for example, Baguio, you don't want your structure to be purely wood. Why? Because the molds and the humidity level on those areas are very high that it tends to make your wood structure absorb and expand. So pagka madaming moisture content yung inabsorb ni wood, may tendency na yung wood structures nyo ay mag-expand because of the absorptance of the moisture. And when it has humidity, it will be prone to termite attacks. So, yun, naanayin. So, the second that we want to tackle when considering the climate condition is specifying the materials and, of course, the design. Our example is in Baguio, as you can see from the image. So, we don't want our buildings to be just flat. because the existing site conditions of Baguio are relevant to undulating slopes to moderately high slopes. So gusto natin na yung structures natin mas stable. And therefore, we must use other forms of design na nag-aallow para maka-adapt yung structure natin sa slopes na yon. So one thing na na-recognize ko in these particular areas in Baguio is that they use steel construction. Most of the buildings use steel construction. So makikita nyo mamaya kung ano yung steel construction, ano yung itsura nun. And of course, when you visit Baguio, you will see houses like that. And then we head on to another issues when specifying materials because of an existing climate and environment condition. So another example is the rivers or oceans. So rivers or oceans tend to have different scenarios when it comes to specification of materials. So when specifying materials, it would help if you will not consider using galvanized iron in your buildings when specifying. Why? Because of the high salt level present in the atmosphere near this beach or ocean, ayaw mo na maging yung GI sheets mo and other things na nagko-corrode will deteriorate because of the rust corrosion. So rust corrosion is very sensitive now as a choice. Rust corrosion is very sensitive considerations when you're choosing materials. So it depends on the location of your site. So iko-consider nyo dapat yung environment initially when you're creating your designs and specifying materials. Another design consideration is the form of our roof. So tropical countries or snowy regions use this roof to block or make water drainage much more manageable. So as you have discussed in your TOWA, slope steepy roof is very recommended towards tropical countries or snowy regions because of the purpose na para mas madaling madrain yung water coming from the rain or the snow. Kapag ka nainitan yun, of course, magiging mako-convert siya into water. So snow or water will from the top will be quickly drained because of the steep slopes in our roof forms. So in dry climates, we use flat roofs. So for the reason that flat roofs are much more effective in conducting heat. So malilimit niya yung heat coming from the sun because i-absorb niya lahat dito. At this, for example, this is your roof. Tama si araw, i-absorb lang niya yung heat. So pagka na-absorb niya yung heat at night, it will the heat collected during the day will now then evaporate upwards. So mas malamig yung experience kapag gagabi. And the size of windows. So windows or the sizes of windows are much more significant in regions when there is snow. So mapapansin natin in Arctic regions, the North and the South Poles, they uses much more bigger windows. As you notice also from like in the USA, you know, you will see that the sizes of their windows are big, allowing for maximum heat gain. So of course, mas gusto nila ng natural light coming from the sun, and then of course, yung law na sinasabi natin na kapag ka landmass yan or anything concrete, ang tendency nun is mag-store siya ng heat when is stricken down or pagka tinatamaan siya ng araw, may tendency siyang mag-collect ng heat. Of course, yung surrounding area nun makakaranas ng temperature increase. So very very maganda siya towards those cold climates that we are experiencing in the North and South. So at the same time, there is a standard size in your windows or our windows here in the Philippines. So, because also as a tropical country, meron tayong two seasons, the summer and the rainy season. So sa summer, of course, as much as possible, we want to limit the heat coming from the sun. So of course, we are in the middle ground of the cold and heat. So dapat flexible din yung magiging window natin. So that's why, as you can see, maraming standard sizes ng windows from the window market. Kung mapapansin nyo, magtitingin-tingin kayo ng bintana, iisa lang yung size. Because it is the recommended size na mag-aalaw ng tamang heat lang or tamang light lang at summer and then of course in rainy days of course tamang heat pa din, no? To make our living spaces much comfortable, no? Kahit malamig na nag-aalaw ka pa din ng heat coming from the sun and allowing also for the natural light coming from it. So in dry climates naman, when comparing the sizes, you notice that the windows design is much smaller because they don't want heat and light coming into their house because a much harsher temperature and heat gain is expected in their countries or areas. So be mindful of those things. And then when designing, I want to add to the built environment when creating in terms of the topography, as I am saying kanina. So this is what we call stealth construction. Like in the mountainous regions, you will notice mainly in Baguio, they use stealth construction, as I have said before. So when located above water, they still use stealth construction, as you've seen from the right picture. Houses in piers uses stealth construction. When located above water, they still use stealth construction, and also notice the choice of materials. Most of them use just wood for their facade and some windows and concrete. So, and within these instances, you will notice that the reason why yung certain structures are half concrete, half wood, within the lalong-lalo na kapag ang site mo is nasa gitna ng island, because of this one thing, the contractors are having a hard time because of the lack of natural water. And kapag ginamit nila yung water coming from the sea, hindi maganda yung magiging concrete mix. So may tendency. So ang chemical composition of cement is only for clean drinking water as specified in the product's description. So kung i-research nyo, ang nakalagay dun sa brochure niya, clean or distilled drinking water or chlorine treated water. So why clean drinking water? Because yung strength ng concrete ay magwi-weaken once na yung salt water or dirty water yung gagamitin mo sa mixture. So that's why some of the houses we can see near the ocean or in the middle of an island are not purely cement, because there is a lack of water resources within the vicinity. So most of the above considerations are mentioned when designing a specific, when initially creating your plans and designs. So in summary, the choice of materials, site conditions, slopes, some construction situations, windows and roof designs are considered based on the current climate and environment.